Hey there, fellas. Having just fixed the generator in this Model A, I swore to myself never to do anything like that again. So today, we are going to take care of the generator in this Model T.
Los, kommt es überhaupt dran ganz unten?
Ja, nee.
Ja,
ja. Ja, das ist Katastrophe. Ich kaufe mir wieder ein Pferd.
Ich wundere mich immer, dass es halt dann doch so eng ist, ne?
Ja, man sagt ja immer, der Tee so schrauberfreundlich. So, und um die jetzt hier rauszukriegen, muss ich den Kummer abmachen, oder was? Ist das nicht wahr? Ja, scheiße.
Ach, das geht so.
Ja, geil. Och, Henry, was?
Ich kann aber doch eigentlich nicht sagen.
Well, I'm a plain country boy and I work on the farm. I mind my own business, don't do no harm. The time rolls around and it's Saturday. I'm gonna Cadillac to town in my Model A. I'm gonna Cadillac to town in my Model A.
After taking this thing apart, I'm pretty sure that the only reason this ran so poorly was number one, grease on the commutator. This is just full of it. And number two, old wiring, because these here, you know, I can't tell if they are the original, but they are certainly very old, and I have no doubt that there is quite a lot of resistance in here. Might even be poor connection between, you know, one of these oxidized pieces here. That doesn't mean this didn't need taking apart. Because what I found out is one of these wires has been rubbing against the armature right in here. You can see it's dangerously close to rubbing the wire through. And then there's this. Healthy bearing sounds a little different and I can feel it. Maybe you can see it. Take a look at this bearing right here. See it walking? Yep, it needs some attention. And I'm not even going to bother heating it up. I'm going to buy myself a bearing puller. There, I said it. There you go. Not even any heat required. Man, why didn't I buy this earlier? I'm going to chuck this side here in the chuck and I'm going to rotate this gradually as I tighten so there is really no other way for the chuck to grip it crooked. There you go, tight. Now I turn this and see how far the end here is out.
Telling where love may appear, something in my heart. if I had it in my power, I'd arrange for every boy to have your chance. Then every minute, every hour, every girl would find what I found in your arms. So everybody loves somebody sometimes. Made it well worth waiting for someone like you.
Now this one here looks different than the others. You can see it's got more turns and less thickness, and I think that makes sense on the thinnest brush. So since it's still quite snappy, I'm going to leave it in. Now you can see a red dot on here. This is where I marked me which one of these brushes I want to be seeing when the notch here is facing up. So this one goes in here like that, and then we'll loosely tighten up the screws on this one here, because we'll have to adjust the brush position later on. I didn't connect the third brush yet, because the next step is to center the brushes relative to the fuel coils. We do that by putting 6 volts onto this thing, this time with the negative to ground, because it's a Model T, not a Model A. And plus goes over here. There you go, 6 volts. And now we want to rotate this brush assembly until it has a tendency to go clockwise. So right now it's going counterclockwise. Now we're going to move this around. Now it stops. Here it's going that way. And we want to find the point at which it stops. But yeah, you may see it, that it's trying to, and moving it that way, no sorry. Still no, this way easier. Now it's about the same, so we want to go a little bit further that way. And now it feels easier this way, and that way it's hard to turn. Okay. Tighten these guys here down. Now we can put the third brush in place. The third brush is still movable because I didn't tighten the nut all the way down. As you can see, I can still move this one about, and setting that for the proper charging rate will be done with a running engine at about cruising speed. With the lights on, you should have around zero, and that's your proper charging rate.
Creature. doctor, tell me what can worry be? I'm crazy about my baby, and my baby's crazy about me. Mr. Cupid was our teacher, that's the reason we agree. I'm crazy about my baby, and my baby's crazy about me. Parson, get your book out, ready in your hand. Keep a steady lookout, you can understand.
It was interesting to see the different characteristics of a Model A versus Model T generator, where the Model A generator is heavily discharging at idle and only produces its peak voltage around 30-35 miles per hour. The Model T generator is pretty constant all the way throughout, however it is much more limited to current. It's not able to deliver any more than 10 amps, where the Model A generator will happily deliver 35 if it has to. Now, of course, it was time to go for a ride. Driving a Model T is very much different to any modern car. You have a hand throttle on the steering column, and what you might call a handbrake lever is actually sort of a mode selector. Pull it all the way back is park, with the brakes engaged and the engine in neutral. Pulling it forward halfway will put you into maneuvering mode, with the left pedal pressed in, meaning going forward, and the middle pedal pressed in, meaning to go backwards. Very handy for parking or doing a three-point turn or rocking yourself out of a ditch. And moving the lever all the way forward is your driving cruising mode, with the pedal on the left pressed down, meaning first speed, in the middle, meaning neutral, and the pedal let off, being in second. The pedal on the very right is the brakes, but you really don't use it that much. You do your braking mostly by shifting the engine into first speed by pressing the left pedal down, and then doing the very last bit of stopping from 3 miles an hour to zero with the brake pedal. Now it was my turn behind the wheel, and having watched a gazillion of videos on how to drive one of these, I gotta say, it wasn't all that bad. Sure, the steering is super quick, the brakes are utterly useless, and you do not want to meet a pothole on account of not having any shock absorbers and the car ending at the height of your lap. But assuming there was no traffic, and no hills, and the speed limit was 35, I can completely understand Henry Ford saying you don't need much more than a Model T to get you around. It's true. I wouldn't want to drive one these days, but back in the day, probably all it took you to get from A to B.
Ja, relativ schnell drauf. Machst du jetzt hier aus?
When the ride came to an end, it was hard to wipe that silly grin off my face. I thoroughly enjoyed that day, getting to know the Model T with all its quirks, and finding out what it's like to drive two immediate successors of one another during an era when cars evolved as quickly as computers do nowadays. Thanks a lot for watching. Keep your stick on the ice. Bye bye.